Hey everybody, welcome back. This time, we're covering the third 15-tip installment of the low-level Iron Man Tips and Tricks series. Tip number 1, train on ammonite crabs, especially if you want to AFK. If you want to grind out some combat levels while paying little attention so you can watch a show or movie, train on ammonite crabs on Fossil Island. To unlock them, you'll need to complete the Bone Voyage quest to access the island, which requires 100 kudos to start, as well as you might want 21 construction in order to rebuild the bank chest once you get to the island itself. Like sand and rock crabs, ammonites have no defenses and a max hit of 1, but they actually have 100 health versus a sand crab's 60 or a rock crab's 50. The icing on the cake here is that they have a small chance of dropping various sized fossils that can be identified and then turned into the Varrock Museum for dozens of experience lamps and kudos. You'll also get a bunch of pneumolites, a currency used on Fossil Island for multiple activities. Number 2, start doing birdhouse runs as early as you can. With the release of Fossil Island came a new passive hunter method called birdhouse trapping, which rewards a great amount of hunter experience relative to the time spent, as well as bird's nests containing valuable seeds and sometimes jewelry and even clue scrolls. Here's what you need to unlock this method. Completion of the Bone Voyage quest, which requires 100 kudos, at least 5 hunter, at least 8 crafting to be able to make clockworks at a crafting table 2, and for Iron Man, at least 25 construction in order to be able to make that crafting level 2 in your player own house in the first place. Alongside that, there's a transportation system on Fossil Island involving the magic mush trees, which you must first discover in person before being able to fast travel from the main mush tree in the house on the hill. You do not need to unlock the sticky swamp location for birdhouse runs, which is fine because then you won't have to deal with the level 132 tar monster. To prepare for a birdhouse run, here's what you need in your inventory. When doing it for the first time, you want to craft 4 birdhouses using a hammer, chisel, 4 clockworks, and 4 logs of an appropriate level. When doing it every other time, you don't need the clockworks as they'll be refunded, but you will need the logs. And it's also beneficial to bring a 5th clockwork on subsequent runs, as you can save a little bit of time crafting a birdhouse while running between locations. You'll also need 40 low-level hop seeds in order to bait the birdhouses, 10 each. If you need hop seeds, the seed shop in Draenor has multiple kinds for sale. Here's the method. Make your way to the house on the hill on Fossil Island as you did during the Bone Voyage quest. The fastest way there is using a dig site pendant, which you can take directly to the house if you unlock the location by using the pendant on the southern machine in the house itself during the Bone Voyage quest, or any time afterward. Assuming you unlock the magic mush tree locations ahead of time, take the mush tree in the house on the hill to the Verdant Valley and set up the 2 birdhouses there. Remember to bait them with your hop seeds before leaving. Then take the mush tree back to the mushroom forest and run north to set up a 3rd birdhouse. From here, you want to run straight south to the entrance of the tar swamp where you can set up the 4th and final birdhouse. From here on, you just need to wait at least 50 minutes after placing the last birdhouse before coming back to collect your loot. Build the next set of birdhouses and then replace and rebait them all. Rinse and repeat from here on out. Fossil Island actually has a ton of valuable stuff for low to mid-level Iron Man, and though we touched on a couple things here, we'll cover more of it in a future video. Number 3. Buy your nails, don't smith them. On top of training construction, several quests require steel nails, nearly 500 in total. So to save yourself the hassle from having to grind out the ore, then smelt it, and then smith it, just go to the sawmill operator northeast of Varrock to purchase steel nails for 3 GP each. You can right-click buy 50 without worrying, as they don't increase in price as the stock changes, like most store stocks do. Note that while normal construction requires nails, the Mahogany Homes contracts that came out recently do not. But note that the Daddy's Home mini-quests, which you need to complete in order to open up Mahogany Homes, does require nails. Number 4. Get free planks from Barbarian Assault for quests and early construction training. Related to the last tip, on top of training construction, several quests also require normal planks, around 58 in total, but some can be acquired during their respective quests. A great way to get free planks for those quests, as well as some quick and easy construction levels early on, is to take the Barbarian Assault minigame teleport and run east to the north side of the Barbarian Outpost agility course. There you'll find 4 spawns of planks, which you can pick up before world hopping 7 times to fill up your inventory. The Barbarian Assault bank is a short run to the west. Note that you do need to have been to Barbarian Assault at least once to complete or skip the tutorial prior to unlocking the minigame teleport. If using the planks for construction, note that they work like metal bars do when smithing. No matter what you're making, they reward the same experience per plank, making it easy to calculate how many you need to level up. For normal planks, that's 29 XP each. Number 5, exploring early fletching training. even better with 40 ranged. If you want to completely eliminate having to do woodcutting during your early fletching grind, go to the top floor of the Lumbridge Castle and pick up the normal log spawns on the north side of the bank. World hop until you get a full inventory, and then fletch them into arrow shafts. Repeat as needed until you get a decent stack. After getting the requisite arrow shafts, you can purchase feather packs from a fishing shop, and then make your way to Catherby's archery shop to purchase bronze, iron, and or steel arrow tips for dirt cheap. If you're making steel arrows, you can recoup some cash to continue the fletching grind by selling the arrows back for the same base price you bought the arrow tips for. However, if you have at least 40 ranged, you can completely cut out the arrow shaft gathering process because you have access to the Ranging Guild and its archery shop. The great thing about that is that it sells arrow shafts, so the only thing you need to bring are coins and feathers. Just like in Catherby, if you're making arrows from steel up to rune, you can sell the arrows back for the same base price you bought the arrow tips for a little cash back to continue your grind. Number 6. Utilize the Culinaromancer's Chest Food Store. After you finish the first subquest of Recipe for Disaster, you'll unlock access to the food store in the Culinaromancer's Chest in the Lumbridge Basement, which contains a lot of useful ingredients for quests and cooking training, specifically grapes, jugs of wine, and chocolate bars. Whenever you're in Lumbridge after unlocking the chest, buy some grapes and jugs to make wines, as well as chocolate bars to grind into dust for energy potions. You'll have a huge stack of them before you know it. Plus, once you complete at least 5 subquests, the stock of each item triples or quintuples, so the more you quest, the faster your supplies will grow. Number 7. Fast and free food for emergencies. If you're ever caught in a situation where you're low on health and or poisoned with no food remaining, and you won't be able to make it to a bank in time, there's a quick source of free food you can get near the Ardwin Monastery, provided you have the Ardy Diary Cape, of course, which every low-level Iron Man should acquire as early as possible. To get the food, simply take the cape teleport to the Ardwin Monastery and run northeast to the Tower of Life. Outside of the tower, you'll see a group of contractor NPCs dicking around. You can pickpocket any one of them for a triangle sandwich that heals 6 health. This can be done an infinite number of times, is a 100% drop, and can be done starting at level 1, giving 8 experience per pickpocket. Number 8. Get early super anti-poisons for free. While regular anti-poisons can be made starting at level 5 herb lore, their effects only last for 90 seconds, plus unicorn horns can take a good deal of time to get for low levels. Instead, you can minigame teleport to Castle Wars and head northeast toward the observatory. The hut to the southeast of the observatory dungeon entrance contains a one-dose super anti-poison, the effects of which last for 6 minutes. That's 4 times longer than a regular one. Simply hop worlds after picking up each dose, and then combine the vials. In total, that's 24 minutes of anti-poison per inventory space as opposed to 6 minutes. A huge difference. Number 9. Certain random events are actually helpful when grinding. Some random events, such as the Gravedigger, Freaky Forester, and Prison Pete, have deposit boxes inside of the event that you can utilize when doing gathering activities or when killing something with a lot of drops that causes your inventory to fill up fast. Simply take the teleport to the event, deposit your unnecessary items, and then either complete the event or talk to the person there to leave the event early, allowing you to extend whatever activity you're doing. Number 10. The Shades of Morden minigame can be soloed. A tip that's hopefully commonly known, but if it's not, we'll make it so, is that if you don't want to bother with scanning the Shades of Morden clan chat while waiting for enough questers to show up to do the minigame, you can do it entirely by yourself if you're willing to shell out 13k coins on a flame tear hammer from the Morden General Store, as well as crafting 3-4 jade bracelets that you can enchant into flame tear bracelets. But if you go during prime time, odds are there's going to be enough people there to do it as a group, and even if there aren't, asking nicely enough in the Shades clan chat may result in someone teleporting over to help. I want to note that Jagex has said they're revamping the Shades of Morden minigame soon, including releasing new rewards, so this activity is about to become a lot more popular. Bonus tip, get a free 335 herblore experience post Shades of Morden. Related to the Shades of Morden, in order to start the quest in the first place, you have to collect the Diary of Irby Flax from a bookshelf to the southwest. But did you know that you can take that book to the apothecary in Varrock after the quest and exchange it for 335 herblore experience? It's not much, but every bit of herblore experience matters for Iron Man, especially early on. Number 11. Cleaning finds in the Varrock Museum is now way better. Most players are probably aware of the specimen cleaning activity in the Varrock Museum that unlocks after completing the dig site quest, mainly for the 5 artifacts worth 10 kudos each, the 1 in 51 chance of receiving a clean necklace that you can then enchant into a dig site pendant, and mainly the 2 out of 195 chance for a 500 XP land. However, I wanted to bring it up because at some point in the past whatever years, Jagex added a quality of life update to the activity, so you can now spam click the pile to pick up the unclean finds far faster, and then auto clean them on the bench, which I don't recall being a thing, but I could be wrong. In short, speeding up the process speeds up the rate at which you'll get lamps, so if you want to use that as a method for a restricted Ironman account or to supplement a certain grind while collecting iron, coal, and mithril ore, iron knives, darts, bolts, and arrow tips, uncut jades and opals, and big bones, it's not a bad idea at all. Number 12. Pick Phoenix Gang for Shield of Arav / Heroes Quest. When joining the official Shield of Arav clan chat, OSRS SOA, while doing Shield of Arav and later Heroes Quest, I discovered that the majority of players, myself included, picked the Black Arm Gang. This resulted in a lot of people not being able to find a partner when they needed it, or even trying to bribe a Phoenix Gang member to help them instead of someone else. I saw anywhere from 50 to 300k being offered for the sake of convenience. Relatedly, people who have finished either quest will sometimes offer a service, also around 50 to 300k, to assist opposite gang members, so that could be an opportunity for you to make a little side cash for a bond on a separate account. Also, during the Heroes Quest, only Black Arm Gang members are required to have a black full helm, plate body, and plate legs, which at its cheapest totals 7.1k if purchased from their respective stores, so you can avoid that by picking the Phoenix Gang. However, once you eventually gain access to the Warriors Guild, you'll need at least a black full helm, plate body, and plate legs, or mithril, to get tokens, so the money and items technically aren't wasted. Number 13. Exploring early money-making methods. The two most common early Ironman money-making methods that everybody knows about are the Agility Pyramid and Thieving from Hand Storerooms. The Agility Pyramid can be accessed after 30 agility, but is usually done at 50 plus to fail less obstacles, meaning getting more money. At the top of the pyramid, you can pick up the Golden Pyramid Top that can then be traded to Simon Templeton nearby for 10k gold, rinse and repeat. As discussed in the last video, you can steal jewelry from Hand Storerooms after completion of the Death to the Dorgeshan quest, and then sell any excess to Grum's Gold Exchange and Port Sarum. But I'd also tacked on that you can enchant the amulet specifically and sell them on Brimhaven for extra cash. A bonus for doing this method is that you'll get multiple easy clue scrolls that can also net you extra gold. But if you're tired of those old methods, another method involving hunting sandworms exists in Port Piscarilius after getting 15 hunter and 30 Piscarilius favor, which can be done by completing the Client of Corin quest and then the Queen of Thieves quest. Hunting for sandworms is a great way to get some early hunter experience on the side, which is an otherwise slow grind. It's also the fastest method from getting 30 to 100% Piscarilius favor, taking less than an hour to do so if you're efficient about it. Simply bring a spade and an inventory of buckets to the hunting site in the northeast corner and dig up the sandworms, dumping the buckets of sand as you go. Once you fill up your inventory, head south to Tynan's shop and then sell your sandworms to him for a decent amount of cash, netting anywhere from 100 to 150k per hour. This method is actually fantastic before doing the Agility Pyramid method, as the pyramid requires much higher levels in agility to be able to match the money that you can make from sandworms. Eventually, it can actually double it, of course, once you get high enough agility levels, but by then, you'll have way better methods unlocked. An honorable mention should be made for collecting steel plate bodies from the middle of the lava maze in the wilderness. This is a very old method, but a tried and true one. The fastest way to get there is to teleport to the south side of the lava maze using an enchanted red topaz amulet, aka a burning amulet. The second fastest way to get there would be to minigame teleport to Clan Wars, and then take the Wilderness Obelisk to the southeast to the level 44 location, but both of those are PKing hotspots. Plus, you need a high tier of the Wilderness Diary to be able to control where you go on the Wilderness Obelisks, otherwise it's random each time. The safest way to get there would be to minigame teleport to Clan Wars, and then hop to a 500 total free-to-play world to run the rest of the way to avoid PKers. Once there, run through the lava maze to the center and pick up an inventory of steel plate bodies, and then head back the way you came. You can sell the plate bodies to the armor store in Varrock for a base price of 1200 coins each, if you world hop each time, of course. That's 33.6k for a full inventory of steel plate bodies, which isn't a lot, but considering it has zero requirements and can be done in about 15 minutes, the method has its uses. Another honorable mention is farming points at LMS to buy rune arrows that you can then sell to shops, but first, the best option would be to get 75 points to purchase a rune pouch, which you'll use for the rest of the time you play that account. Number 14, fruit stalls reward a bunch of goodies. With the release of Zaya came the advent of fruit stalls, and once you have level 25 thieving as well as 15% Hasidia's favor, you can make your way over to the Hasidia's town square to steal from the stalls. There's a bank a short distance to the west and even a farming store nearby that sells baskets, which you can bring several of to store fruit while thieving to extend your trips. While there are two guard dogs in the area that will aggro to you if you're caught, there's a safe spot you can utilize by blocking both dogs between the wooden posts on either side of the stall. The stall is incredibly useful for several reasons, the biggest of which is the run energy restoring fruit it gives. Strange fruit, normally only obtained through the strange plant random event and from the chaos elemental, can be acquired here at a low rate, and they restore 30% energy when eaten. You can also get papayas, which restore 5% run energy, or they can be used to make super compost. Fruit stalls are also the only location in the game where you can get Gulva Nova fruit tops, which will eventually be used to make botanical pies at 52 cooking, and that boosts herb lore by 4 levels. Fruit stalls also give cooking apples, bananas, and strawberries, all of which can be stored in the baskets I mentioned. The baskets of apples and bananas can be used to pay farmers to protect your trees from disease, and the baskets of strawberries are actually a great source of food, especially as your HP level grows because each one restores 1 plus 6% of your total health. At its maximum, this equals 30 health in a single inventory space. For reference, a shark only heals 20. The stalls also give red berries, which are needed for multiple quests and in making red dyes, as well as pineapples, which can be used to make super compost, and jangerberries, which are used for a couple of quests and can also be used to make super compost. The limes and lemons aren't very useful, but it is possible a lime will be chosen for the Fairy Tale Part 1 quest where you're asked to acquire 3 random items from a list, so it would be good to save at least one of those. Number 15, learn some zero time methods. Certain activities like fletching darts or bolts, high alking, or enchanting jewelry can be done in between certain actions, or while running between locations during other activities. These are called zero time methods as you're effectively spending no additional time on them. The most common place people do these is during agility, specifically during rooftop courses, as there's plenty of time in between obstacles where you can get a cast off or make multiple sets of darts. It's a neat little trick you can start doing early on that only compounds later once you acquire larger and larger stacks of items to fletch or alchemize. Burying bones also falls under this category. When you're fighting enemies, bury a bone as soon as you get XP for the attack and then immediately click on the enemy again. Doing it this way results in no time loss between attacks. And there you have it, another 15 low-level Iron Man tips and tricks. There's at least one more of these coming out at some point, but it'll likely take a bit longer as originally the 60 tips I had was eventually consolidated into 48 or so due to some of them going with other tips or not being big enough to be more than a bonus tip. But it will come out. Thanks again for watching, everybody. Feel free to subscribe if you're interested in seeing more, and I will see you next time. Have a good one.